Hello, and welcome to the Hudgins Family History Project. John Foster Hudgins and his wife Fanny Wallace, our great-great-grandparents, are the focus of our story. In 1842, a hard-working couple, John Foster Hudgins, his wife Fanny Wallace, and their three young sons, John, James, and Humphrey, left Kentucky by covered wagon to settle in Mooresville, Livingston County, Missouri. Some of John and Fanny's descendants still call the Mooresville area home. Others have settled across the country. We are farmers and business owners, teachers, soldiers, doctors, and politicians. But mostly we're ordinary folks. Our ancestors fought in the Revolutionary War and the Civil War, and we believe even for Scottish independence. They lived and they loved, and they are a part of who we are today. John and Fanny's parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents are also of interest. Let's begin with Fanny's side of the family, the Browns and the Wallaces, who left Scotland to establish roots in America. But not for them and the decisions they made over 200 years ago, we would not be who we are today.
A severe storm was brewing in Chesapeake Bay. 19-year-old Gustavus Brown had just arrived from Scotland and had gone ashore while his ship lay at anchor. The storm intensified just as he was returning to the harbor, where he found his ship abandoned and drifting out to sea. Young Brown had studied medicine in Edinburgh and become a surgeon's mate on a royal ship that was headed for America. His job was to assist with surgery, treat the crew for the many maladies of the day, and to look after any royal passengers. Now, with nothing but the clothes on his back, he persuaded the citizens of the small village of Port Tobacco, Charles County, Maryland, to provide him with instruments and medicines. There he became Dr. Brown, and a prominent, well-respected citizen.
Gustavus, 21, and now Dr. Brown, married 19-year-old Frances Folk, a daughter of wealthy landowner Gerard Folk, in 1710. Their first child, a son, was born a year later, but died soon after. Frances bore 11 more children, 10 of whom survived and 9 of whom were daughters. The 9 Miss Browns, as they were known, became part of the Brown family legend. Though he was now comfortably settled in Maryland, Dr. Brown was eager to return to his homeland. He packed up his wife and 10 children and sailed for Scotland. Such voyages often took many weeks and could be brutal even with the best of accommodations. But just 2 years later, and Mrs. Brown finding Scotland not to her liking, they set sail again back to America in 1734. This time with 15-year-old Michael Wallace in tow. 11-year-old Elizabeth Brown was destined to fall in love with young Michael and become the ancestral link between the Browns and the Wallaces.
Michael Wallace had been orphaned after his parents died in Scotland at an early age. His uncles, Thomas and Michael, now guardians, arranged for Dr. Brown, known for training young men in the medical field, to take him in as an indentured apprentice to study physic, pharmacy, and surgery. His papers state, in part, that the said Dr. Gustavus Brown will pay for the passage of Michael Wallace to the said county in Maryland to furnish and provide meat, drink, clothing, lodgings, washing, and all other necessaries as becomes an apprentice. And for his part, the said Michael Wallace shall forbear all gaming, drinking, and keeping of idle company, and shall not, during his said apprenticeship, have any patients of his own under cure, nor reveal the diseases of any of Dr. Brown's patients.
Well, we were talking about the fact that our Wallace ancestor went over to America in 1734. Uh-huh. And so missed all the turmoil that came. And then the way he came over was that his father had died young, while he was young, and his two uncles, who were merchants in Glasgow, apprenticed him to a doctor, a Scottish doctor named Gustavus Brown. And they both came over to America. So our Michael Wallace was apprenticed to Gustavus Brown, who had nine daughters. And every time he had an apprentices, they all fancied the daughters, but he always said no, he wasn't going to have that.
Many of Dr. Brown's medical students were enchanted by the beautiful nine Miss Browns. But the young apprentice, Michael, now 21, was especially attracted to Elizabeth, 17, and fell in love with her, and she with him. When his proposal for her hand in marriage met with the same opposition from Dr. Brown as those of other suitors of his daughters, Michael decided to run away with his bride. They eloped at night as Elizabeth secretly climbed through a second-story window of her father's house, while his medical students held the ladder and awaited her below. Dr. Brown is reported to have said later, as she was just one of his many daughters, "I saw no practical reason to retrieve her."
After eloping, newlyweds Michael and Elizabeth settled here at Ellerslie, Virginia, around 1750. Ellerslie was named by Michael for his ancestral estate, Elderslie, in Renfrewshire, Scotland, and its line of the great patriot family Wallace, who fought for Scottish independence in the 13th century. Their home on this 400-acre estate is still standing after 250 years and has been lovingly restored by private owners. Michael and Elizabeth had nine children, all born here at Ellerslie, and one of whom, William Brown Wallace, was Fanny's father. Fanny's father served with distinction in the American Revolution, as did his five brothers. His reflections on the Revolutionary War are remarkable and will be highlighted here in gratitude to him for leaving us this chronicle and for his contribution to the historic founding of this nation.
From early in the Revolution to the peace of 1783, I remained a lieutenant in the Army of the United States upwards of 7 years. I was, perhaps, the oldest subordinate in the Army. I had, among my companions, the honorable title of the old sub. The following narrative will best account for this extraordinary situation. At the age of 18, after serving in a volunteer company against Lord Dunmore, the Royal Governor of Virginia, I abandoned my education and enlisted with the first regular troops raised in the 2nd Virginia Regiment. The year was 1775.
In 1775, just before enlisting in the Continental Army, Wallace was recruited by a volunteer company of Virginia militia engaged in a conflict with their own governor, British Lord Dunmore, once popular and well-respected. Now the contentious Dunmore was agitating, creating a citizen uprising, and blocking every attempt of the colonists to voice their concerns about the British Parliament. First and foremost, in Wallace's words, was its arrogance in assuming the right to tax their American subjects. And fellow Virginian, outspoken Patrick Henry, passionately called for an armed resistance, for to stand by idly, he said, and do nothing would be far too costly. Forbid it, Almighty God! I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death. Uneasy over the rumblings of a rebellion, Dunmore ordered a crackdown on any sentiment he thought disloyal to England. And by the time Wallace entered the fray, Dunmore had secretly confiscated several kegs of gunpowder he thought might be used against the British regulars. The Virginia militia called for more volunteers and sharpshooters to stop Dunmore's men and seize the stolen explosives. Again, Patrick Henry, outraged by the governor's actions, demanded retribution and payment for the stolen ammunition. Dunmore conceded, but declared Henry an enemy of the state. The incident became known as the Gunpowder Affair and is described in a letter written by Wallace to his brother. Dear brother, I don't doubt you have heard of the great disturbance our governor has occasioned by taking the ammunition and locks from the guns out of the magazine in Williamsburg, privately in the night, which occasioned about 4 days after upwards of 1,000 men to assemble, among which were 600 good riflemen. In September 1775, William Brown Wallace enlisted in the newly formed Continental Army in the 2nd Virginia Regiment. It was commanded by Colonel William Woodford. On July 4th, 1776, Willie, as he was affectionately known, was just 19 in Colonel Woodford's regiment, still battling Lord Dunmore, when news broke of a Declaration of Independence that had been adopted by Congress in Philadelphia. For days, the people of Philadelphia and the northern colonies celebrated, but the 2nd Virginia Regiment had an unfinished matter to attend to. It was to remove Lord Dunmore from office once and for all. General Andrew Lewis, commander of Colonel Woodford's troops, planned to launch an amphibious assault on Dunmore's men camped on Gwynn's Island on the Rappahannock River. But before the attack could be executed, Dunmore, realizing he had lost control of Virginia, fled with his family to an awaiting British ship that would return him to England, narrowly escaping cannon fire as they sailed away. He was the last royal to hold office in Virginia. On July 8, 1776, the first copies of the Declaration were read publicly and handed out for all generals to read aloud to their troops.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Wallace later wrote about his country and its vow of independence. She has taken a conspicuous stand among the nations of the earth. In 1777, Wallace joined Colonel William Grayson's additional regiment and was made second lieutenant. Grayson's regiment was one of 16 raised by General Washington himself, in addition to those approved by Congress. It had been only a few weeks earlier that Washington made his historic Christmas Day crossing of the Delaware River, waging a surprise attack on the Hessian army and capturing Trenton and Princeton. Now Congress had renewed confidence in the general and was more willing to relinquish control of the army to him, temporarily anyway. Before that, the pathetic army, beset with illness and troubles on all fronts, had been in rapid decline. Troops were unmotivated, abandoning their commitment and returning to their crops. But now their faith in the commander-in-chief had been restored. The colonists were re-energized, and men were now eager to enlist. Washington's army had swelled to over 12,000 soldiers, a significant factor in the Battle of Saratoga, where Wallace and Grayson's regiment were headed. Gentleman Johnny Burgoyne, they called him, threatened to split up the northern and southern colonies and bring a quick end to the rebellion. His plan was to capture New York's capital, Albany, and take control of the Hudson River. Burgoyne, a published writer and better suited as a playwright than a general, insisted that he take command of the invasion, even though British generals Sir William Howe and Henry Clinton were more experienced.
Two factors that had nothing to do with military genius contributed to the outcome at Saratoga and ultimately changed the course of the Revolution. For the first time, the Continental Army had experienced a sizable buildup of troops, outnumbering British forces by 2-1 in this campaign. And communication among British generals Howe, Clinton, and Burgoyne were lacking, or careless at best.
Burgoyne's men had just regrouped after retreating from a skirmish that nearly cost them the battle. Now they awaited further orders. Burgoyne also waited. He assumed that he had the support from Howe and Clinton that he needed. Howe would join him at Saratoga from Canada, but never came, going instead to Philadelphia. Clinton would bring food, supplies, and ammunition that arrived too late. Burgoyne waited for 3 weeks for their arrival before making the decision to try another attack with his now weakened army. Benedict Arnold, second in command to Horatio Gates, was the best field commander Washington had. Fearless and independent, he had fought hard for Washington and did not disappoint at Saratoga. Wounded and suffering a shattered leg, he led the charge to seize the earthworks where Burgoyne's fatigued and discouraged men were returning fire. They were soon surrounded by Gates' army and surrendered on October 17, 1777, filing by one, laying down arms as the Patriots watched. Gates took credit for the victory, but Arnold proved to have the superior military skills.
A decisive victory for the Continental Army and their new hero, Horatio Gates, considered now to be a possible replacement for General Washington, should anything happen to him. But more importantly, it convinced France that assisting the American forces could ensure a British defeat and liberty for this new nation. Had either of the two factors at Saratoga been different, the Revolution would have been lost.
A letter written by William Wallace to his brother and published in A Salute to Courage reflects his joy in the defeat of the enemy at Saratoga. I wrote you some time ago concerning the defeat of our northern tyrant Burgoyne. We have taken 5,000 prisoners, all his artillery, baggage, military stores, and the friends to liberty may now with propriety rejoice.
We don't know if Lieutenant Wallace endured that brutal and deadly winter at Valley Forge. Records show that his regiment was there during that time. But according to his muster roll, he was granted furlough in November of 1777 and probably didn't return to his regiment until the following spring.
Fishing Creek, about 40 miles away from the Battle of Camden, South Carolina, had been a hideout for the Continental Army in 1780, or so thought Colonel Thomas Sumter, in charge of the troops there. He had made the decision to march his men, including Wallace's company of artillery, to the creek to rest and refresh 2 days after the battle had concluded. The decision later proved to be a military blunder, and it would be Wallace's last battle. Washington needed a strong, defensive southern campaign now to contain British General Charles Cornwallis's advance southward. Wallace, now assigned to the 1st Continental Artillery, and several infantry regiments were called in as reinforcements, some with very little training.
In April 1780, I marched from Morristown in Jersey, to South Carolina, under the Baron de Kalb.
Major General Johann de Kalb had been called up by Washington to head the campaign at Camden, but was quickly losing control. Congress then ordered Horatio Gates, hero of Saratoga, to replace DeKalb and secure Camden quickly. After careless tactical mistakes and ill-advised maneuvers, Gates soon proved unfit for the command, as did his troops for battle. The British opened fire on the ill-prepared Continental Army, causing a significant number of casualties. Cornwallis then launched a bayonet charge that panicked the infantry. But it was the cavalry charge from the rear that scattered the hopeless army, breaking their formation before they broke and fled. A few of the remaining troops fought the onslaught for some time, but they too soon turned and ran. In a shocking act of cowardice, General Horatio Gates jumped on his fastest horse and fled over 60 miles from the battle. Cornwallis had successfully exploited Gates' overconfidence and cost him any future military command. He was finished. Now in retreat at Fishing Creek on Sumter's orders, Wallace's artillery company was soon decimated in a stealth attack by the British. Undetected as they approached, attacked, and captured the exhausted troops resting along the banks of the creek. Sumter himself, dozing under a wagon, immediately scrambled out from under it and ran, abandoning his men and his boots, escaping just before being captured. Wallace and his comrades were not so lucky. He tells his story.
2 days after the Battle of Camden, I was captured at Sumter's Defeat, or Fishing Creek. I was stripped to my shirt and pantaloons and marched barefooted and bareheaded 16 miles to Charleston, often nearly perishing for want of food and exposed to the chilling dews at night and burning sun in the day. I was taken under guard and confined in a damp, filthy hole of a galley, without food, for days, charged falsely with holding a correspondence with a privateer, for which I was informed I was to be hung. And after remaining for several days in this situation, I was informed that the only alternative to save me was to engage in His Majesty's service as a common sailor. Finding I would not purchase my life with degrading defection, I was restored to my parole on the island. But when brought on deck to be discharged, I had every reason to believe I was to die. I was, however, permitted to obtain the uniform of an American officer and invited to spend the evening with some British officers. I hesitated, having hitherto experienced the most opprobrious language and every species of ill-treatment from members of that army with whom I had to do. But their polite professions to make my time as agreeable as possible induced me to accept, and I soon found them agreeable enough to place me at ease. At length, one surprised me by proposing a toast.
You will have no objection, sir. I give you General Washington.
And in due time he called for a sentiment from me. He perhaps expected the king, but as General Washington was no king, I, willing to return the civility, gave Earl Cornwallis.
Very good. I hope to see you wear a red coat, sir.
I had wanted a coat during my captivity, but hoped I would not change with the color which necessity might compel me to wear.
Look at your rebel cause. Charleston has fallen. Your cavalry is defeated, and your generals, Gates and Sumter, are defeated. Arnold has returned to his allegiance and has turned his arms against you. And there are more Arnolds than one in your army. Your militia, disaffected and worn down with service, cannot be gotten into the field in any force. The war, in short, is about to terminate against you, and doubtless you are not unacquainted with the history of rebellions. His Majesty will see the necessity of severe and extensive examples to ensure better government of the colonies in the future. He offers a full pardon, to all who will relinquish their rebellion by taking the oath of allegiance, in which case you may dispose of yourself. But I have a proposition which I would not make if I thought it would be offensive, in which I believe I should not only be serving my king and my country, but you also.
I desire to hear it.
Our officers had attempted, without success, to enlist the rebel prisoners, and if your own officers would engage in the business, it might be done. If you would undertake it, you should have the same rank you held in the rebel army, and the bounty money put into your hands the next morning to try the experiment that a regiment be raised of the prisoners, and commanded by Lord Montague.
If I should take up arms against what I had been taught to believe in a righteous cause, against a country that gave me birth and all my friends, and if the fortune of war should throw me into the hands of those people you called rebels, I should die an ignominious death, with a much worse conscience than if I should make my exit as a rebel.
If you will not accept the proposition, I request you do not mention it to your fellow prisoners that such had been made.
He finally, on parting, requested that as I would not then accept of the proposition, not to mention to my fellow prisoners that such had been made, and to take time to consider of it. It was, however, communicated the following evening to my fellow prisoners at Hadrill's Point. Perhaps it was more of credit than disgrace to the American prisoners that on so trying an occasion, not more than two officers joined Lord Montague's regiment.
Camden and Fishing Creek were two of the last few remaining battles of the Revolutionary War. For the next 14 months, until the surrender of General Cornwallis to General Washington at Yorktown in 1781, Wallace remained a prisoner of war, confined to Hadrill's Point, South Carolina, where he was required to swear under oath to do nothing or to cause nothing prejudicial against His Majesty's arms. Soon after the war, Wallace married Barbara Tunstall Fox in Spotsylvania County, Virginia, where she grew up. He had grown up not far at the family's beloved Ellerslie, where it is likely she met the handsome lieutenant. William Wallace was well educated, a poet, storyteller, and respected officer in the American Revolution. Barbara can be traced through her mother, Philadelphia Herndon, to the royal line of Plantagenet kings, most notably John, signer of the Magna Carta. A daughter was born to William Wallace and Barbara Fox in 1795, the fourth of eight children, and became the link between the Wallaces of Scotland and Hudgins of Mooresville, Missouri. Her name was Fanny Wallace. Little Fanny Wallace was just 4 years old when it looked as if her father would march off to war again, a possible war with France, the Quasi-War, or XYZ affair as it was known, and fought primarily at sea. It was an undeclared war, but threatened the stability of the newly formed nation nevertheless.
There is a gross misunderstanding with France that I must reconcile, said President John Adams. At Mount Vernon, enjoying his first day as retired ex-president, George Washington sat down at his desk to sort out plantation paperwork, writing in his diary that day in March 1797, "At home, all day, alone."
His idyllic retirement was soon disrupted when he was asked by Adams to return from private life and prepare to command a provisional army. "We cannot survive another war," Adams said. In a letter to Washington, William Wallace offers his services. Washington would not live to carry out the command.
"Sir, presuming that the provincial army is yet in contemplation, and that the appointments may not yet be completed, I beg leave to offer my service. Not having the honor of a personal acquaintance with your excellency."
Mount Vernon, July 29th, 1799. Sir, I have received your letter of 24th instant, wherein you offer yourself as a candidate for an appointment in the Provisional Army. Measures are now taking to select proper characters for officers in this army, and as it is desirable to obtain those.
As it turned out, the quasi-war ended by treaty, signed by John Adams and Napoleon Bonaparte in 1800, almost a year after Washington's death. There was no war, and Fanny's father never fought again. He closes his letter to Washington with these poignant words, "I shall not stand an idle spectator if I should, unfortunately, live to see my country bleed again." It's interesting to note that while Fanny's father, Lieutenant William Brown Wallace, was a distinguished officer in the Revolutionary War, as were all her uncles, it was Fanny's great-uncle who was a personal friend of George Washington and attended him in his last illness. While we won't follow his ancestry here, Dr. Brown II is himself worth a moment's discussion.
He was educated at Edinburgh Medical School, like his father of the same name. In fact, they have often been confused in genealogy sources. According to the most reliable, Hayden's Virginia genealogies, the younger Brown was part of George and Martha Washington's social circle. They were neighbors and often visited each other. Brown and Washington were alike in many ways. The Journal of the American Medical Association in 1883 states that Dr. Brown, like his father, was a man of fine personal appearance and, like Washington, over 6 feet in height, of pleasant and affable manners, and the very soul of wit and good company. Just as George Washington, he was fond of botany, and cultivated with great care and success an extensive garden of rare flowers for their beauty and for their medicinal properties.
There are many accounts of what the doctors did that day to save the life of George Washington. But the one recorded by Tobias Lear, General Washington's private secretary, is the most accurate and is told here. Lear's account shows that Dr. Brown arrived at Mount Vernon from Port Tobacco around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 7 hours before the general took his last breath. A severe infection and swelling of the throat was slowly suffocating him. Accepted practice of the day for severe illness was bleeding, which required a small incision in the vein to allow a free flow of blood, usually a small amount. The procedure was thought to rid the patient of infection and restore the body to good health. After suffering fever and chills during the night, Washington insisted on being bled the next morning. In accordance with this senseless custom of the period, blood was drawn, and the procedure repeated 3 times more with the approval of Drs. Craik and Brown. A third physician, Dr. E. Cullen Dick, was against the procedure. Within a few hours, Washington lost more than a quart of blood that could scarcely be spared and most certainly hastened his death. Few, if any, doctors knew of anything better.
The three physicians fully recognized from the first the gravity of the case and were untiring in their efforts to relieve their illustrious patient. They never left the home and rarely the bedside until death asserted its victory over the first citizen and most beloved man in America. General Washington was the personal friend of each one of these physicians. In a letter a few weeks after Washington's death, Dr. Brown records his own impressions of the illness that ended so valuable a life.
"You must remember he was averse to bleeding the general, and I have often thought that if we had acted according to his suggestion when he said that he needs all his strength, bleeding will diminish it, and if we had taken no more blood from him, our good friend might have been alive now. But we were governed by the best light we had, We thought we were right, and so we are justified.
Wallace and his family moved to Kentucky in 1817, where over 2,600 acres of bounty land were waiting for him in payment for his years of service in the war. Lieutenant William Brown Wallace and his wife Barbara remained there for the rest of their lives and died at their home on the same day in 1833 of cholera. Fanny's sister Anne commissioned this portrait of their distinguished father a few years before his death.
This is Liverpool, England, where we began our story of the Hudgins family. Historic seaport and now an industrial city of about 50,000 people. Its economy still relies heavily on shipping and related trades, and a boom in tourism, being named the European City of Culture in 2006.
We really don't know too much about Thomas Hudgins, except that he was born in Liverpool, England, around 1620, after his parents moved from nearby Llandaff, Wales. Thomas is the first of the Hudgins line born outside of Wales and is the earliest known ancestor of the Hudgins family of Livingston County, Missouri.
Thomas was 40 years old when he and his wife, Elizabeth, had their only child, a son, Robert Hudgins. Robert also grew up in Liverpool and probably followed his father's occupation of shipbuilding. It is reported that he was also the sheriff of Llandaff in Wales. But most importantly to this story, he and his wife Charlotte were the parents of the four brothers who sailed to Virginia in 1742.
One of those immigrants became the grandfather of John Noble Hudgins, born in 1762 in Tidewater, Virginia,
where, it is interesting to note, George Washington was also born 30 years earlier. John Noble was a fine carpenter and shipbuilder. His shipyard was located in the Potato Neck area of Virginia, named for its primary crop, and where he became known as Noble John, John Noble, and Potato Neck John. Nancy tells this story.
John Noble Hudgins and Amelia Foster lived in this area, where the abundance of trees and the nearness of the waterways was conducive to shipbuilding, which we believe is what John Noble did. We don't know how large or how small those ships might have been. And he might have done some farming as well. When John Noble Hudgins and Amelia Foster Hudgins died, they were buried on property in this area.
John Noble was probably too young to enlist in the Continental Army, having turned 19 just as hostilities ended. But, like so many citizens of the day, it is believed he did render aid to the Army by providing much-needed food. His contribution of 95 pounds of bacon and 600 pounds of beef made him a respected patriot of the American Revolution, and most likely earned him the nickname Noble John. He may have also contributed his shipbuilding skills to the Continental Navy, as legend has it that a cousin, Holder Hudgins, also a shipbuilder, presented a war vessel to General Andrew Lewis in the American Revolution. Noble John married Amelia Foster, also of the Potato Neck area, and of their five children, two sons, John Foster and William, left Virginia, most likely in search of promising new business opportunities afforded by the expanding western frontier. They headed to Kentucky, probably around 1806, or soon after the Lewis and Clark expedition, and settled near Salt River.
Whiskey, whiskey, Nancy, oh. I went down through Galway City, Nancy whiskey.
John Foster Hudgins learned the art of distilling whiskey while living in Anderson County, Kentucky during the early 19th century. It was there that he met 22-year-old Fanny Wallace soon after her family arrived from Virginia. In 1823, John Foster married Fanny, and like his father, John Noble, he made his living as a skilled carpenter and cabinet maker. Now he also had a successful whiskey business, refining his grain recipe and distilling his own fine Kentucky bourbon near Salt River. The river was named Salt because of the natural salt licks that the early frontier settlers found while hunting in the area. John Foster Hudgins made trips up and down the Ohio, Mississippi, Missouri, and Arkansas rivers, selling his whiskey, and the river trade kept him away from home for long periods of time.
Dear Fanny, I take my pen to inform you that you may expect me home in 10 or 15 days from this time. This leaves me in tolerable health at this time, but I've had a long, tedious time of this trip, not only of body, but of mind. Such that I cannot pretend to describe. Tell this to no living soul. I expect to lose $1,000. Tell Mr. Ryan if there's any whiskey worth selling, and he can sell it for the money to do so. Let John know that I'm coming home and give my respects to my friends and my love to my boy, and receive the prayers of your devoted husband until death. John F. Hudgins, 1830, St. Louis, Missouri.
His tender letters home to Fanny in 1829 and 1830 reflect his homesickness and how much he missed her and his four-year-old son, John. James and Humphrey were not yet born.
Let me know how my boy comes on, and if he talks about me, buy some cakes and give it to him. Oh, how I would like to hear John chatter and embrace him. You must keep him for me, but not spoil him by sparing the rod. Your husband until death, John F. Hudgins, 1829, near Vicksburg, Mississippi.
This diary entry of Fanny's reflects her loneliness as well. Spent the day alone, expecting Mr. Hudgins every hour. February 28, 1830, Salt River. By the mid-1830s, Kentucky, like most states, was experiencing a severe recession and high unemployment. President Andrew Jackson made matters worse by ordering the withdrawal of all federal funds from the Bank of the United States, he thought favored East Coast bankers, and depositing the funds into a small group of state banks. The move created an economic crisis that was considered one of the worst in the country's history. After the Panic of 1837, offers for cheap land and lots of it in Missouri looked inviting to William. It was time to move on. He left Kentucky and headed west to Missouri, where he eventually became a very wealthy landowner. Much of his land is still owned today by his descendants. William's brother, John Foster, was also facing difficulty selling his whiskey in hard financial times. By 1840, whiskey sold for a record low of 25 cents a gallon. And he was facing mounting social pressure to ban the making and selling of whiskey altogether, although it was still legal in those days. The popular temperance movement prevailed throughout the early 19th century and beyond.
There is in this place preaching two or three times a week in a temperance society, and I think there are more lip drinkers here than in Kentucky.
After he was well established, William encouraged his brother John Foster to come to Missouri, where the bountiful cropland and rolling hills were so reminiscent of the Kentucky they both once knew. In 1840, John Foster sold his holdings in Kentucky, packed up his Kentucky Turnpike wagon, and began the journey to Missouri. This workbench that he built, and that became the very core of his livelihood, is a gift to Missouritown in Jackson County, and is on display. It is believed to have been brought with him to Missouri by covered wagon. John Foster Hudgins, his brother William, and their families became prominent pioneer settlers of northern Missouri.
Fanny Wallace Hudgins died, most likely of cholera, in 1844. She was just 49 years old. Her two sons, James, our great-grandfather, and Humphrey, were 12 and 13. Their oldest brother, John, was 18. John Foster did eventually marry again, and after the boys returned home from the gold fields of California, they married and began their families. John had 12 children. James had a daughter, Angeline, and two sons, Gilbert and Thomas. Humphrey didn't have any children. The boys continued to help their father on his farm until he died in 1869 at the age of 82.
love spell to know. While to my fond word she listens,